Hello friends, today we start a new series on Mathew, Arnold, Culture and Anarchy. Culture and Anarchy, the full title is Culture and Anarchy, an Essay in Political and Social Criticism. It is first published in Cornhill Magazine. During 1867-68, during this period, it was published in Cornhill Magazine and it was first published in book form in 1869. So that is about publication, simple thing, yes. Now we see, we have already done some 10 lectures on Mathew, Arnold, the study of poetry. You may know that. No, have you gone through that? Yes. As a poet and critic, he was the most considerable figure, literary figure, of the mid-Victorian period. We had other great Victorians, you remember, no? That is Browning and Tennyson. But in criticism, they have nothing comparable with his brilliant essays. That is Arnold's brilliant essays. But in his poetry, of course, he is only third, first Tennyson and then Browning, and third rank we will give to Mathew, Arnold. But for essays, criticism, and for culture, and this is like brilliant essays like this, he has no competitor. There's no competitor. Now what you see is Culture and Anarchy is at once a masterpiece. It has become a classic, you know, classic, a masterpiece of vivacious prose. Vivacious prose means very lively. The prose is very lively. And a profound religious work. So you can say that it is a classic. It is a classic, it's a masterpiece. You can call it like this, you know, as one, it is classic. It is a classic. Then you can say it is a masterpiece. A masterpiece of one, you can say vivacious prose. Vivacious prose. Then secondly, you can say profound religious work. A profound religious work, masterpiece, it's a vivacious prose, profound religious work, and then you can see a great poet's brilliant defense of poetry. A brilliant defense of poetry. Brilliant defense of poetry. There's a fourth point in order about this. A brilliant defense of poetry and the finest apology for education in the English language. So you can say apology for education. Apology here means not saying sorry. Apology means defense. Apologetic fathers of the second century. Apologetic fathers means those church fathers who defended the church. Faith of the church. They are called apologetic fathers. Bacon calls them apologetic fathers. Origin, for example. Origin. Origin is a great apologetic father. Now here, apology for education. Apology for education in English language. The finest apology, not only just any apology, the finest apology for education in the English language. Why English language? You remember I told you, no? Those days, even during the Victorian period, the Latin, the dominance of Latin and Greek was still there, so it should be taught in vernacular. Education should be in vernacular, that is English. another modern languages, isn't it? So you can say that it's a classic, published in Cornfield magazine, then as a book, in book form. Then you find that the 4 points note here about the text as such, which is a vivacious prose, means very, if you get time, you must really definitely go through the original, then you will understand what is meant by vivacious prose. Quotations of course will be given, from that also you will be able to understand it. Then profound religious work, because half of it is all Hebraism. Hebraism here means spiritual life, spirituality, religion, kingdom of God, how to bring kingdom of God on heaven. Sometime, somewhere he has said that culture is nothing but kingdom of God within you and on earth. So to that extent is a religious work. Brilliant defense of poetry, we have already seen study of poetry. The end of, you remember that the last part of study of poetry, if mankind has to survive in this world, what have you to do? You should read poetry. And the survival of mankind is assured because there are poets. That's what he said. Since there are poets, the survival of the mankind is assured. And lastly, education. He was an educationist par excellence, you can say. A great educationist. As you can see, his father was a great influence on him. Because his father himself was an educationist, he was a master of rugby. And the son naturally must have inherited some genetic material from him. And another great influence upon him was the religious genius, that is Newman. See that? And he was also under the influence of the Oxford movement, the Tractarian movement. So the two mentors of his life, we can say his father and the other father. The other father is the church father, that is Newman. Understand? So from there, and as an educationist, I told you know that all the day he used to say that what is culture? Culture is the ripe fruit of education. This is one of the many definitions are there, but one definition is this, the ripe, in connection with education, he says, it is the ripe fruit of education. So at the end of the education of a course, if you take, then you ought to become a man of culture. So as an educationist, in experience and in insight, he was far ahead of his contemporaries and most of his present successors. So two qualities you should understand, in experience and in insight. There is nobody, he was incomparable. Incomparable. Hindi we say anupam. Anupam. You cannot compare with anybody. His insight, his brilliance, his plans for the future, even his present successes, they don't come anywhere near. He stood for organization of higher education under the state control. As it is. Now you can see now people are paying crores, spending millions of rupees on education in private schools, but my management school and so on, you say no. But here he says he stood for this. Yeah, that's it. That's very important, my state control. Because he, for collecting data for Tandon Commission and also for education purposes, he travelled abroad. And then he came into contact with other educational institutions and policy of education and the education, the infrastructure, etc., developed by the state. For example, he quotes the example of the schools in Prussia. Under the crown's control, crown schools in Prussia, crown that is state, the king. So the education was the primary obligation or duty of the state, and therefore he said we must also have the same thing. So he organization of higher education under the state control, and crown schools as you find in Prussia. And he learned much from his journeys abroad, the educational programs. And he was instrumental to organizing a system of secondary schools for the education of the middle classes. That's the thing. Culture. 1857, he was appointed professor of poetry at Oxford, and the chair he retained for about 10 years. He was a liberal. Like Newman, he was a liberal. Like his father, he was a liberal. And they were batting for non-residential rugby schools made available for the whole of England. For the whole of England, under state supervision. And there began what we call the concept of modern public school system. The modern public school system is the founder of the modern public school system. Along with his father and also Newman, this who became later Cardinal Newman. Yes, public system. The whole burden of Arnold's writings, the focus of Arnold's writings, you can see the spread of secondary and university education. So, by far, he was the greatest of the educationists of the Victorian time. He was the founder of modern criticism, you know. So that also, I think, in study of poetry, we saw he had got his ideas of personal estimate, historic estimate, and real estimate. So from this idea of real estimate came forth the statements like made later by his late, that is, the honest criticism and sensible appreciation should be directed not upon the poet but upon the poetry. And from there you have got a whole lot of new critics who are John Crow, Ransom and so on, you know those names, I think. So they are insisting on not the poet, the author, but the poem, the new criticism, practical criticism, I.A. Richards and so on. So the founder, the foundation system, so he was the founder of how many things? One, culture is, viewing culture as seriously. Second, you have got is an educationist, the founder of modern public schools. Third, he was the first Oxford professor in poetry, professor of poetry, who lectured in English. That's very important. As professor of poetry, first one. The third first. And fourth, he was the founder of modern criticism. That is, the direction, attention should be given to the text and not to the author, not to the social situation, environment. Environment might have played somewhere. And that is, from there you have gone up to Ronald Barth, depth of the author and so on. Understand that, which we, I hope, will be able to see later. Now about cultural anarchy, you can see there are six chapters in it. Just give you an overview of this. Six chapters. I think by way of introduction, this is enough. For the time being, we can now enter into the text as such. So, four first to his credit. I hope you understand that, isn't it? What is the first one? First is his culture, focus on culture. The first person who took culture seriously. Second, an educationist. Third, the founder of modern public schools. And fourth, a great defender. Sorry, Rindan Keshi, I'll say one more. The great defender of defender. Many people are defended poetry. For this, the founder of modern criticism. Now when you get into this, you know, this, the world of ideas, when you start reading, you will find this. There are six chapters and one or two words about those six chapters I will say, because those of you who are interested in reading it straight away can start reading. This vivacious prose. Most probably, if you consider Dryden as the founder of the modern prose, we have seen the brilliant prose of Dryden. Now next, as a prose writer, we can say the next great man in the line is Mathew, Arnold. M-A-T-T-H-E-W. Very often people make mistake like this. See, my name is also part of that. So, but there is only one T, not double T, only single T. And that's enough for me. So you can see there are half a dozen chapters are there. And these chapters are divided like this. So very interesting to see. First one is, he says, sweetness and light. Chapter 1. Sweetness and light. And what is sweetness, you know? What is sweetness? Dulce. Dulce. Horace. Remember Horace? Dulce et utile. So here it is. Sweetness. Love. Pleasure. In Horace it is pleasure in connection with the work of art. But here it is love. Relationship. Love. Love, human relationship. And light means reason. Reason. Love and reason. That is friendship and reason. Love if your neighbor and reason. Light means let there be light. Let there be reason. You know, Lucifer. Lucifer, you know. So Lucifer means one who carries light. Lux. The Latin word is lux. L-U-X. L-U-X. Lux means light. So Lucifer means light. One who carries light. Listen. And now Ferrer, you know, Ferrer means to carry across. Transfer. Take it from one place to another. Right? Ferry service means you are taken from one place to another. Now that's about the origin of this word. So that is light. Light means reason. So lot of things about what is love, neighborhood relationship. You cannot live alone. See, no man is an island. Alone you cannot think of progress. And such ideas are there. Very, I must say that is very important for not only in the Victorian period, even now. It has great relevance. So every student should read this. Because when you go out of your college, you know, you become a cultured person. You don't want to become an uncultured person. So you should feel it. See that? And then second chapter is doing as one likes. Doing as one likes. That means doing as one likes, what will happen, you know? Anarchy. So then what happened? There will be anarchy. That is no authority. Culture and anarchy. Anarchy means no authority. You are not obeying an authority. You are not under any authority. Or you are not submitting yourself to an authority. Imagine a life without that. Every human being, whatever position he or she has to submit himself or herself to some authority. Sorry. As otherwise, what can happen? Naturally, anarchy. Think of your family. There's nobody obeys. There's no sender, no authority. A class without a teacher, or a teacher who does not use his authority, what will happen in the class? Definitely will become a place of anarchy. No doubt. Understand? And the third chapter is Hebraism and Hellenism. Third chapter. Hebraism and Hellenism. Now I am giving you this introduction like this because those of you who wish to read this in advanced reading, you can make it, start reading. It's not the third chapter, it's not Hellenism, that is fourth chapter, I'm sorry. That is third chapter is Barbarians. Big word, no? Barbarians, Philistines, and Poblas. Sorry, that is the third. Barbarians, Philistines, and Poblas. not hopeless but hopeless. Yes, there is anarchy, it is a hopeless situation, isn't it? Yes. In this case it is barbarians, uncultured people. That means he means aristocrats, the so-called noblemen, the upper class, so to say, the rich class. In communist terminology you say bourgeois, that is barbarians. No culture, uncouth people, uncultured people. That's what he calls them. The English society he is dividing like this. His own society. Says part of it is barbarian and part of it is Philistine. Philistines means those people who are bent after, or they have craze for money making. Nothing else in life. Just money making. That's all. They focus everything. From morning till evening, 24 hours, they think of money, how to make money as well. So that's what Milton says, you can take all the possessions from a greedy man. But one thing you cannot take, and what is that? His greed. So these Philistines are greedy people. For them everything is money. Bond make money. They see everything in terms of money. If they attend a class, they will say, what will I get out? If they go to an excursion, they will say, what will I get out of? If they go, if they arrange a dinner, they will say, what will I get out of? If they arrange, if they celebrate a festival, then what will I get out of it? So always they have an axed ground, they say. Some selfish interest. For them, everything is selfish interest. Everything for promoting their selfish interest. Such people are Philistines. This is, you understand that? Mathew, Arnold himself speaking about his own society. So here it is, Philistine. And then you have got populous, means working class people. Who find it difficult to make both ends meet. They are both ends meet. That is income and expenditure. Poor people. So you have got three groups of people, classes of people in England. So he is addressing cultural anarchy to these three classes of people. Understand? Now fourth is Hebraism and Hellenism. Fourth point is, fourth chapter is Hebraism and Hellenism. Hellenism, I think, is known to you. You know, when you study John Gibbs, you know, Hellenism of John Gibbs, we said. I mean, Greek influence. Hellenism. Nothing to do with Helen, a beautiful lady for whom the Trojan War was fought. No, not there. Hellenism. So that is, means the physical culture, bodybuilding, physical culture, aesthetic life, all about life out, means all about this life. This. Hebraism is just the opposite, you can imagine what is it, all about other life. Other life means you prepare, this world is meant for preparing ourselves, yourself and me, to take you to the other world. Where you have got 17, 18, or we can say unending, infinite, forever happiness and pleasure and whatever. So this life you suffer, mortify, do penance, lead a spiritual life, then what will happen? And that is Hebraism. Hebraism means religious life. Hebraism means spiritual life. Hebraism means you are working, whatever you do is for your soul. Hebraism means making you ready for the next world. Hebraism means you should sacrifice things for the next world. And just the opposite of that you find Hellenism. They least bother about the other world. They are concerned about this world, the pleasures of this world. Eat, drink and be merry, because we don't know what is going to happen tomorrow. Listen, eat, drink and be merry. But we must not forget that eating and drinking cannot go on for long. Suppose you have got, you like biryani, okay, some chicken biryani or some. How many chicken biryanis you can eat? After some day, there will be a ceiling. Your body will put a ceiling. None of these things cannot continue for long. Summer will not last long. Summer means not this kind of summer, but the summer of, as Shakespeare said, shall I compare thee to a summer's day, that kind of summer. That means it's beautiful, isn't it? Very charming. Summer in England is very charming and beautiful. People say Shakespeare says like that. I have never gone to, no, I haven't gone to England to find out whether it is charming or not. And now coming back to this Hellenism means this. Worldly affairs, enjoy, play games, build your physique, keep your health, eat whatever you want, drink whatever you want, and enjoy. But culture is, according to Mathew Arnold, a confluence of both. A confluence of both. There should be Hellenism and also Hebraism. Hellenism should be mixed with Hebraism, and Hebraism should be mixed with Hellenism. Hebraism comes from the word, you know, if you know St. Paul's letters, epistles of St. Paul's letters, one of the letters is titled Hebrews. Hebrews means letter addressed to the Hebrew. So that is Hebraism means. In that letter, St. Paul is talking about a spiritual life. See that spiritual life, for getting yourself ready for the life in the other world. So, but Arnold says that both should be there. One should not be cultivated at the expense of the other. Then what will happen? It will be cancer. See that? You know what is cancer? Cancer means what? Uncontrolled multiplication of cells somewhere. See, it can be your heart or any place. So that is growth. That is not. Then it becomes cancer. Like for example, suppose there is a person who always studies 24 hours, always thinking about studies, that's a kind of, but we must say, there is no balance. He forgets the golden rule of Aristotle, the golden mean. That is the golden rule. Virtu stat in media. When we were discussing Aristotle's Poetics, on which I have given about 20 lectures, so we have said Aristotle's golden mean is virtu, virtu. Virtu means virtue, Latin. Virtu stat in media. Media means, this is culture. Media means middle. Virtue stands in the middle. For example, studying is good, but not 24 hours. Study 6 hours. 6 hours you sleep. 6 hours you enjoy. 6 hours you go with the friends. Understand? Not all. So that is balance. You like biryani? Eat once in a while. Okay? I know. You like jalebi? Suppose you eat 50 jalebis at one sitting, what will happen to you? But virtu start in medium, 1, 2, maximum 3. Not more than that. So that is, Hebraism will teach you that. Hebraism speaks about that, and Mathew Arnold quotes this balance, middle, virtue stands in the middle. This is the golden rule of Aristotle. In everything you should. For example, I have seen students spending 24 hours, 22 hours on mobile phone, doing like this. If I get into, sometimes I find when I travel by bus, if there are 30 passengers, except myself, all the 29 passengers are doing like this. That is too much. So they don't know the golden mean, the rule of the golden mean given to us by the great Aristotle. Okay, we are not going to, this is not a class on the golden mean, but I said that this is, golden mean is a very important ingredient of culture. You can indulge in anything, but it should be balance. There should be balance. Balance should be kept. Understand? So that is fourth chapter. See? Then the fifth chapter is Poro unum est necessarium. That is Latin. Poro, Latin. Unum. Unum est necessarium. Necessarium. This necessarium, you know, necessity. Necessary, needful. Necessary, it is necessary for students to attend the class. Necessary or needful. Like that. So necessary. Est means is. When we were doing Indo-European family of languages, you know, on which I have given about 60 lectures, the history of the English language, and then we saw est is one form of is. Indo-European family, members of the Indo-European family of languages, you find this est, es, as, etc. Asmi. See this in Sanskrit, because Sanskrit is a member of the Indo-European family. So est means is needful. Unum, you know, unanimous decision, one. Everybody agrees, one, unanimous. Unity, one, oneness, union, one. So it comes from this word. So means one is needful. One is needful. Unum est necessary. Porum is still. Still. Still, one is, still there is one thing needful. That is the meaning. Still there is one thing needful. That is the meaning of this. Still there is one thing needful. So again, you know, the focus is on education, culture and religious life. Trio. These three things will take you full development, take you to full development, perfection. Culture according to Mathew Arnold is perfection. Perfection of the human being. So there is a famous statement by him. It is not having something, but growing. That is culture. See, for example, if you say you get your NET qualified, you become a teacher, a professor, and then okay enough. You don't do anything. That is not culture. Culture means you should grow from there. That is culture. In other words, you are perfection. You should not say there shouldn't be stagnancy. Standard growth is not perfection. You grow, and then stop. No. Till that's why it's now the best teacher is the best student. There's a statement saying like this now. Who is the best teacher? The best teacher is the best student. So till the end of his life, till he breathes his last, he should be reading and studying, but keeping the other thing in mind. Golden mean. He should go for films, attend festivals, go for festivals, attend matches, watch matches and team meetings, go to park, go excursion with family, all these things you should. Everything should come. So it is said that there will be after having is not the thing, but growing is the most important thing. So I am not going to go anywhere. That is nonsense. No. That is not the thing. You should be a well balanced person. And then you can say you are a cultured person. So still there is one thing needful. Poro unum est. Necessary. Necessary means necessity, need. Est means is. Un means one thing. See, there is a, then in some religion you start a prayer like this. Credo in unum deum. Credo means believe. Credibility comes from that word. Credo in unum deum, one God. See, that is, like this is how the prayer begins. credo, see like this, credo. Credo means I believe in unum. Unum means one, deum. Deum means God. From there you have got English word deity. Deity and so on. This temple is dedicated to this deity vision. So that's, okay, that's about unum. So that is the fifth one. And the sixth chapter is our liberal practitioners. Our sixth chapter. Can you see this? Sixth. Our liberal practitioners. Practitioner, you know. Practitioner of law. Our liberal practitioners. And finally there is a conclusion. So in book form, you have got a half a dozen chapters. You can go through that. Brilliant prose, modern prose. You'll get more than 1,000 new expressions. New combinations, that's the most important. More than new words, but new combinations. Like that of Shakespeare. Multitudinous seas incarnate in and so on. You have such expressions, you will find here also. Understand? So therefore he said, I think that I have taken you, I have like Moses, I am not Moses, but like Moses, I have taken you to the land of Canaan, where there flows honey and milk and honey flow. So this is land of Canaan. You can get in. I can only come up to this place. I cannot get in. I don't have that that boon, or I don't have that that's the gift given to me by God that I should end up. Okay, is that clear to you? I hope you understand. Therefore, my dear friends, once again, culture is a classic, and then we say it's a masterpiece. It's a masterpiece of prose, brilliant prose. You can say it's a masterpiece. Then you can say it is a religious work, it's a profound religious work, it's a great poet's brilliant defense of poetry, and also an apology for education. So the content only this much. Why education? The point. Education is, because education is the fruit of, culture is the fruit of education. Without education, nothing will do. So he was battling, so to say, for the public school system. Non-residential, that's important. Because he did not like non-residential. Residential, it is like a broiler chicken. You are keeping some students in a particular place, boarding, then asking them to cram and learn things by heart, and only the teacher is with them, and tutors and so on. No! When the class is over, you should be free. You should be able to make your own timetable, should be able to follow your own design. Understand? So that is education. Not that I'm always saying, you do this, do that, this thing. The homework, that's homework. No. You should be free to do it. And then we saw that his influences, his own father and the new man. And so we are, he is an educationist, he's a founder of modern criticism, defender of poetry, the first professor of poetry who took lecture in English language. Then we found also that founder of modern criticism. And then we saw when we stand on the border of this land where honey and milk flow. You will see honey and milk in the form of six cups or six huge vessels or whatever you think. Maybe six half a dozen lakes. It's a talab, no? Talab. Yes. There are some lakes, you can't see the other side of it. Such huge lakes are there. Yeah, then. So here you are. So you have got this sweetness and light, that means love and reason, doing as one likes, that means anarchy. See? Third is barbar, the division of the society, a classification of the society into barbarians, Philistines and populace. Barbarians means those influential, rich, aristocratic class, and then Philistines means only greedy people making money, and then how can there be cuts? And the populace means poor people. Poor means working class people. Fourth, we saw Hebraism and Hinduism, very important. That means religion as well as world should go together. Worldly matters and religious matters, spiritual matters and then should go together. No? And then we saw poro unum est necessarium. There is one thing needful. One thing, unum, unanimous unity and so on. Our liberal practitioners and then conclusion. So we will take up one by one. This is first part of my introduction. Now there is one more part for introduction itself, because we have to consider him as a religious thinker, him as a critic, see. And only then we can go. This is only an overview, yes. Now you know some idea about Mathew Arnold. And Mathew Arnold, many firsts he has got, then this book form, you have got half a dozen chapters and so on, at least this much you can remember, published in 1869, first published in Cornfield Magazine, and etc., etc., we can see, we will continue in the next class, that also will be devoted to introducing the text and the author, more aspects of the text and the author. So, till we meet again, bye, have a nice time. I hope you have been enjoying this class and you are following this. If you are following, definitely you must subscribe so that these lectures will be reaching you, say, in a few weeks' time. It's not few weeks, means the second lecture must be already tomorrow or day after tomorrow. So, don't miss updates. So, here it is. Subscribe now for updates. I hope that you understand. Bye. Have a nice time. Enjoy your life.